बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। दिस इज़ मदिहा सगीर फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ जूलॉजी, बैंक रोड कैंपस, यूई, लाहौर। सो स्टूडेंट्स, द टॉपिक विच वी गोना स्टडी टुडे और विच वी डिस्कस टुडे इज वेरिएशंस, राइट? सो व्हाट आर वेरिएशन और व्हाट इज़ द वेरिएशन? ब्रॉडली स्पीकिंग, वेरिएशंस मीन वेराइटी, वेराइटी ऑफ थिंग्स और थिंग्स दैट आर स्लाइटली डिफरेंट फ्रॉम ईच अदर। We can say that the different forms of a single particular thing are the varieties of that particular form, right? That particular thing. Let's take example of human population. If you take example of human population, you can see that the classmate that is sitting behind or besides you is slightly different from you. How? In terms of hair color, in terms of eye color, in terms of height, in terms of weight. Right, so you can see a various forms of humans around you daily. This is what variety, this is what variations, right? So the topic of today that would be more concerned is the study of the variations in the within the single population. You can say the study of variation that are being visible or being observed within a single population. Here comes the major kinds of variations: group variation and individual variation. If we talk about the variations between the different populations, then we could say that these are the group variations. But if we talk about the variations that are visible in a single population, within a single population, that could be referred to as the individual variations. Here comes our actual topic, that is the variations within a single population. The word population, I think you all of know, are very familiar with this word. We used to listen this word around us. Population is what? Population is a group of individuals or group of organisms that are being localized or that are living in a particular specified area. Alright, so if we come to the exact or precise definition of population, then we could say that a population is a localized group of individuals capable of interbreeding and producing fertile offsprings. Means they can interbreed. Interbreed means that they could be the sexual mates of each other and they are able to reproduce their healthy young ones. Now, in case of sexual species, no two individuals are completely alike. I want to give example here that you can feel the difference between your two brothers, right? Even your siblings are quite different from you. You are different. Being a human, even you are different from your brother, you are different from your sister. So the sexual species could never ever be, individuals of sexual species could never ever be alike. Sexual species are those species that reproduce by means of the sexual reproduction by the involvement of the gametes. However, in case of asexual species, that where the asexual reproduction is a common practice, they could have the same or alike individuals. But in case of sexual species where gametes are involved, then no two individuals would be the same, exactly same. Now, these all are variations are much more attractive to the morphologist as well as to the taxonomist. A morphologist, you know, who studies the morphology, the structure and parts of the body or parts of the organism, and taxonomist, a person who categorize the things or who categorize the organisms or plants into different categories. So these variations are very, very much attractive to these two people within the population. Okay, now the types of intrapopulation variations. Intrapopulation, that is intra mean within. So we could say that the variations that are being taken place within the population are also called the intrapopulation variations. Intrapopulation variations could be divided into two major categories. One is non-genetic variation and other one is genetic variation. So, as their name shows, that non-genetic variation would not involve the genes or genetic material, and genetic variations involve the genetic material. The variations, like non-genetic variations, can adapt only to the individual. Why? Because these are the variations that does not involve your DNA. When they does not involve your DNA, they cannot be passed through on to the next generation. So they can only adapt the individual, they cannot adapt the population. On the other hand, the genetic variations, as the genetic variations are due to the genes or DNA, because they involve the genes and they involves the DNA, so they can pass on to the next generation. When they can pass on to the next generation, it means that they can adapt the whole population instead of a single individual. Okay, so either the variability or variation is genetic or non-genetic, how could we know this? How could we explain this, that this variation is genetic or non-genetic? Of phenotypic variability observed in nature, except by careful breeding experiments. So only by doing the experiments, breeding experiments mean reproductive experiments, we could be more focused that either it could be, or we could be more clear that either these variations that we can see in an individual are either genetic or non-genetic variations. What happens sometimes we see the individuals, two individuals that are, that phenotypes are not distinguishable, means they are same. Like if we read here that identical environmental conditions may give rise to indistinguishable phenotypes. Indistinguishable means similar same phenotypes that are produced either by alternation of genotype through natural selection or by non-genetic somatic modification. Right? So what happen if two phenotypes are there? They could arise either by the natural selection, by the change in the genotype, or they could arise by the modification of somatic cells, means the other body cells, that the change does not take place within the gametes or reproductive cells. So to become a more clear that either this variation is genetic or non-genetic, we have to do the breeding experiments. Okay, here comes the first type of intra-population variations, that the variations that are taking place are visible within a single population. The first type is non-genetic variations. Again, as I told you in previous slide, that non-genetic variations are the those variations that does not involve the genetic makeup, or that does not alter the genes and or DNA. So non-genetic variations are actually the result of the adaptation to the environmental factors or different things that are around you. When an individual try to adapt to the environment, then these non-genetic variation could become takes place. So and the genetic factors definitely determine the amount and direction of these phenotypic variations. Now the types of the non-genetic variations. We can divide the non-genetic variations into four different types. One is the individual variation in time, social variations, ecological variation, and traumatic variations. If we come to further division, then we could have individual variations into three different forms. That are the age variation, seasonal variation of an individual, and seasonal variation of generations. And we can also classify the ecological variations in further forms, that are the habitat variations, variation induced by temporary environmental conditions, host-determined variations, allometric variations, and neurogenic or color variations. And traumatic variations could be divided into two different forms: accidental and tetralogical variations, and post-mortem changes. This is the whole picture of the different types of non-genetic variations. All right. Okay, right now we are talking about the non-genetic variations. In non-genetic variations, the first one is individual variations in time. And individual variations in time is further categorized into different types. The first one is the age variation. These variations are due to the difference in the age. Why? We can see, everyone knows that some animals are different at their earlier stages or at their larval stages. Their larval stages are quite different from their adult forms. So these variations are due to their age difference. Animals in general pass through a series of juvenile or larval stages in which they may be quite different from adults. Okay, here I want to give you example of the common eel. Eel, you know that it is a fish. So what happened here? This was the eel. The immature stage of the eel, Angula, were originally described as Leptocephalus brevirovitiscop. So what happened? Leptocephalus is the eel. So the immature stages of Angula eel was originally described under the genus of Brevirovitis, but actually later it came to know that it is not the other genus, but it belongs to the same genus. It is just the immature form of the Angula. All right. Okay, the second type of individual variations in time is the seasonal variation of individuals. Adult individuals of certain species of animals are subject to seasonal changes of the phenotype. What happens? Some animals are change their phenotype with the change of the season. For instance, if we give an example of certain mammals that are living in cold regions, they mold themselves, they mold their skin at summers, right? Here I have want to give examples of weasels. Like these weasels, they mold their skin, or molt means they shed off their skin, right? They shed off their skin in summers, and from this color they become they shed off their skin in summers and from this color they become this. Same is the case in case of if we talk about the birds. There is an example of the ptarmigans that in summer they look like this, and in winters they shed their plumage and they becomes like this. Plumage is the layer of the feathers that is being present on the body of the bird. And this is the third type of the individual variations in time, that is the seasonal variation of generations. Previous slide we have talked about the variations that are present in the individual in response to the environment, but here we are talking about the those variations that are due to the that are due to the season, but that are present in the generations instead of the individuals. Because if you take the example of insects, insects have a rapid sequence of generation. They have a several generation in a year. So in this case, the generation that is being produced in summer is different from the generation that is produced in the winter. In a well-known cases, insects here, so summer generations are different from the winter generations, or we can say that dry season individuals are different from the rainy season individuals. These variations are apparently could be the difference in the color of the generation. One generation is of suppose black color, and other generation would be of brown color, right? And in some insects we see the variations in the form of the variation or variety in the wings. Some generations are with long winged, and some generations are wingless, or either they have the short wings. So these are the some generations. Similarly, we can see that individuals which hatch in cool spring are quite different from those individuals that hatch in the summer. So these are the variations that are produced in response to the season. But as we are talking about those organisms that have a rapid sequence of generations, so definitely the variations would involve not only one individual. Variation would involve the whole generation that is being produced in that particular season, either summer, either winter, either spring. Okay, we are discussing the non-genetic variations within a single population. First, we talked about the individual variations in time, and we classified the individual variations in time into further categories like age variation, seasonal variation of individuals, seasonal variation of the generations. Now, here come the second type of non-genetic intra-population variations, that is the social variations. These kinds of variations are mostly seen in the social insects like honeybees, like ants, like wasps. That these insects used to live in the form of the colonies, and in their colonies the individuals have been designated on the different ranks. They have the reproductive caste like queens and males, or drones, may are often called drones. They have the workers and the soldiers. Now, if you talk about the queen, queen is the female member, female reproductive member of the colony, and it is the product of the fertilized egg. Its function in the colony is only, queen is only meant to produce or to lay eggs. And drones are the male reproductive members of the colony, and they are the product of the unfertilized eggs. Rest of the individuals are workers and soldiers that are not at all productive. So they have been given with different functions like foraging food, provision of the food to the colony. They give the protection to the colony. And in if we talk about the honeybees colonies, and there are about 2,000 to 60,000 workers per colony are present. In this picture, you can see the different variations of the insects of the honeybees, different variations of the honeybees in the same population. Like first one are the workers that are shorter in length, and the second are the drone, you know, that the product of the unfertilized eggs, and the third one is queen is a product of the fertilized egg, and queen is very lean and long in the length. Okay, third type of non-genetic intrapopulation variation is ecological variations. Ecological variations are the variations that are due to the relationship of organism to its environment, to its habitat, and it's also the relationship of the relationship of the organism to the other organism of the same population. So first type of ecological variation is the habitat variations. We all know that habitats affects organisms too much. If you talk about the plant, if a seed is planted in a good, well-nourished soil, then it would be very good in the growth. And if the same seed would be planted in a malnourished, poor soil, then its growth will also be poor. In case of humans or other organisms, population of a single species that occur in different habitats in the same region, even the region is same, but habitat is different, your surrounding is different, so you will have the visibly difference in your phenotype as well. Here I have given the example of the oysters. Oysters are, you know, invertebrate shelled organisms, and their shell is divided into parts. One part is known as the valve. Here we have given the different habitat to the oyster. If oyster is grows on a clean water, on pebble, you know, small stones, so which raises it slightly above the bottom level, the lower valve is usually deep, readily ripped, acquiring thus a strength which is not needed when attachment is to the perfectly flat surface, which acts as a shield on the side of the shell. So it is very clear that if oyster shell or oyster shell's valve has a surface or substrate of a pebble, then it will develop many bands on its surface in order to attain the grip on the pebbles, right? In order to attain the grip on the pebbles. Here you can see these are the ribbons or bands that are developed because of the different habitat. If the same oyster would be grown in another environment with the muddy environment, then the shell's bands will be more less. Or we can say that for the same reason, oyster which lie in a muddy bottom with only parts of the valves above the surface are less commonly ribbed. Means these bands, there's no more strength or grip is required. So in this habitat, the bands or ribbons of the shell would be less. The shell is less commonly ribbed.
Okay, second type of ecological variations, the variations induced by temporary climatic conditions. And some animals with highly plastic phenotype may produce year classes that differ visibly from the norm owing to the unusual conditions like drought and cold. Okay, if conditions become much more dry than the normal or much more cold than the normal, then some animals of the population produce temporary change in the phenotype. That is, temporary change is known as the plastic phenotype. Okay, and this temporary change in the phenotype is due to the response to the change in the climate. Third type is host determined variations. In host determined variation, these variations occur due to the change in the host. Host will determine that what kind of variations will be produced. Here we have taken the example of the braconid wasp, Apentalis flaviconchi. And what happened when these wasps feed on blue-green caterpillars, they produce white cocoons. When the same wasp feed on the yellow-green caterpillars, they produce golden cocoons. So difference in the their host, if they have been brought up by the blue-green algae, they produce different color of cocoons, and if we have brought up by the yellow-green caterpillars, they produce the, that was caterpillar, not algae. They produce the golden cocoons, and cocoons, you know that these are the silky protective covering produced by the larva for the protection. Okay, and other type of ecological variations is allometric variations. Well, allometry is also known as the biological scaling. What we do in it, we take the measurements of different body parts or different body organs with respect to the whole body size. So we can use allometry for different physiological traits as well. For example, we measure the heart rate or metabolic rate of an animal with respect to the size of the animal. For example, if size of the animal is much bigger, then its heart rate would be much less. So allometric variations, definitely if animals of different sizes within a population will show different proportions of their body with respect different proportion of their particular body organs or particular body parts with respect to the whole body size. Here I have taken the example of the beetles: deathwatch beetle, click beetle, great silver water beetle, and we have take the measurements of antenna measurements as well as the thorax measurements and abdomen measurements. So these measurements shows the proportion of the body size of these organs with respect to the whole body size. Let's read it. Allometric growth result in disproportionate size of some structure in relation to that of the rest of the body size. If individuals of a population show allometric growth, animals of different size will show allometric variability. If size of animal is different, then its proportions of this body sizes of body organs will also be the different. So this will produce the variation within a population, and those variations are known as the allometric variations. Okay, another type of ecological variations is neurogenic variations or the color variations. These variations are definitely due to the change in the color in response to the environment. A very, very well known and famous example is the chameleons. Now what they do, they can change their color in response to the environment. How they can change their color? They have a layer of cells that are known as the chromatophores. The cells are known as the chromatophores, and that chromatophores actually have the pigment within the cytoplasm. Cells are chromatophore, and they have the pigment that is present within the cytoplasm of the chromatophores. So these are present in three layers. The outermost definitely layer is the transparent skin layer. But beneath the transparent skin layer, they have the three layers of the chromatophores, and those chromatophores have the different pigments. So with the help of those pigments, chameleons change their color. When and how they change their color? Actually, they change their color in response to the temperature, as well as they change color to the camouflage. Whenever they feel any danger around themselves, they want to disguise themselves, or they want to hide themselves from that danger, so they change their colors. Different chameleon species are able to vary their coloration and pattern through combinations of pink, blue, red, orange, green, black, brown, light brown, yellow, and purple. They can have different individuals of the chameleon population can have the different pattern of the colors, and these colors are produced by the combination of the different colors that are mentioned here, like pink, blue, red, orange, green, etc. All right. Okay, the fourth type of non-genetic variation is traumatic variation.
As you know that we are discussing the known genetic variations within a single population. So far we have discussed the three types of known genetic variations with their subtypes. Now the fourth type is a traumatic variation. Traumatic variations are those variations that are caused by some external or physical injury. So first type of the traumatic variation is accidental and tetralogical variations. Tetralogical variations are the same that represents the abnormality in the physiology of an organism. So whenever the organism is induced by some external injury, it may lead to the disturbance in its development, or it may lead to abnormality in its development or hormonal system. So these variations could take place in response to the trauma or physical injury. But in some cases, these variations have been identified at very early stage. But sometimes the physical injury could be in the internal of the body, so it could not be recognized easily. When the same organism undergo the developmental processes or metamorphosis, so the injuries show abnormalities in the adult stage. They have not been recognized in the juvenile stage, but at the adult stage, those injuries show the abnormalities in the development and thus produce the variations within a population. Another type of traumatic variation is post-mortem changes or post-mortem variations. Now, how could they take place? Post mean after, right? And mortem mean death. So these changes takes place after the death of an individual or organism. Here we have taken an example of Chinese jay. This is a bird. When this bird is live, its plumage is of green color. But after preservation, its plumage due to the certain chemical reactions to the preservatives, the plumage turns to the blue. So these variations are known as the post-mortem variations because they were not present in live stage, but they become visible after the death of that particular organisms. And as we take example of the bird, and these changes are occur because of the reaction to the preservatives. Okay, so far we have talked about the known genetic intra-population variations. We have discussed the four different kinds of known genetic variations with their subtypes. Now we are stepping into the genetic variations that are being taking place within the population, within the different individuals of the population. Genetic variation, as their name suggests, that it involves definitely the genes and the DNA sequences. Those individuals vary in their sequences from the other individuals. DNA sequences, you know, these are the nucleotide sequences, and genes are the portion of DNA sequences that can express itself to make the protein. So the changes or the difference in these sequences could lead to the genetic variation within the population. The two main sources of genetic variations are mutation and sexual reproduction. As you know that sexual reproduction involves the meiosis, and there is a crossing over procedure that will lead to the recombination of the genes. So it will lead to the genetic variation consequently, and the mutations are change in the sequence, change in the gene sequence. Sometimes a single nucleotide is replaced, a single nucleotide of the organism is replaced, and sometimes what happen, there are the mutations that are being occurred in the genes, within the sequence of the genes. So these mutation will lead to the different protein, and that different protein ultimately will lead to the individual variations. Types of genetic variations. Now we will explain different types of the genetic variations that are present in a single population. There are these two major types of genetic variation. One is sex-associated genetic variations, and other is the non-sex-associated genetic variations. We can further divide each of these variations into the subdivisions.
Sex associated genetic variations have been divided further into four main types: primary sex differences, secondary sex differences, gynandomorph, and intersexes. And we can also divide the non-sex associated genetic variations into two forms, that are continuous variations and non-continuous variations. Non-continuous variations are also known as the discontinuous variations. So in the coming slides, we will discuss all these variations in detail. So these are all the types of genetic variations with their subtypes. Okay, the first type of the genetic variation is the sex-associated genetic variations. These variations, as their name suggests, are sex-limited, or these variations are due to difference in the gender or sex of the organisms. We have divided the sex-associated genetic variations further into two types. One is the primary sex differences and other is the secondary sex differences. We have divided them four, but here we have talking about in this slide of two main types of the sex associated genetic variations. First is primary sex differences. Now the primary sex differences are due to the differences in the reproductive organs. These are differences are due to the change or difference in the reproductive organ, that is gonads or genitalia. Reproductive organ, either it could be internal or it could be the external reproductive organ. Otherwise, apparently the both male and female organisms look alike or look similar, but the difference is only in their reproductive organs that are being used. The second type of sex associated genetic variations is the secondary sex differences. Now, in first type, primary sex differences are only the difference in the reproductive organs. But secondary sex differences, the differences are quite visible, apparently, between the male and the female organism. Here, I have given the example of the king parrot, Alectus rodentus. You can see on the left side that there is a male parrot that is of green color with orange bill. And on the right side, there is a red and blue parrot that is a female parrot and having the black bills. So these two parrots belongs to the same species, belongs to the same population. But why they are a variant of each other? Because of their different sexes. One is male and other is the female. Another type of the sex-associated variation is the gynandomorph. What happened in gynandomorph? The organism apparently have both female and male characters. Half of the organism is male and half of the organism is the female. Now, when and how this happens? This is due to the mixing of the unequal distribution of the male and female chromosomes. Now maybe you have heard about the hermaphrodite term. Hermaphrodite is different from gynandomorph, because what happened in hermaphrodite? In hermaphrodite, organism having the both male and female genitalia or reproductive organs. But in case of gynandomorph, they could be hermaphrodite, may they have the both organs, or they could have only a single reproductive organ, but apparently or physically they have the both characters. One side is male and the other one is like a female. Third or fourth type of the sex associated variations is the intersexes. Unlike gynandomorphy, intersex is likely to exhibit a blending of male and female characters. They are generally thought to result from upset in the balance between the male and female tendency genes, and these are due to irregularity in the fertilization or mitosis. So this is different from the gynandomorph, in a case that in gynandomorph we can distinguish that this right or left side of the body, suppose right side is like a female and left side is like a male, but in case of intersexes, the whole there is a blend of chromosomes of both male and female, or unequal distribution of the chromosomes. So we can not clearly say that either this individual is a male or it is a female. So these were the four types of sex associated genetic variation. Okay, another type of the genetic variations is non-sex associated genetic variations.
We have talked about the genetic variations. We have divided genetic variations in two main types. One is sex associated genetic variations and other is the non-sex associated genetic variations. So non-sex associated genetic variations definitely will not involve the sex characters for producing the variations. First type of non-sex associated genetic variations is the continuous variation. Why it called continuous? Because it gives us a broad range of measurements. That's why it is known as the continuous variations. You can understand it completely by having different examples. If you talk about human population, we have a different range of heights. We don't have the fixed range of height. Either we have 5 feet or 4 feet or 6 feet. We don't have the specific measurements. We have the very broad range of the measurements. Height is an example of continuous variations. Individuals can have a complete range of heights. For example, it could be 1.6, 1.61, 1.62, 1.625. Like this, even we can have the measurements in decimals. So this is the such kind of variations are known as the continuous variations. Continuous variation is actually the result of the many genes. So that's why they are being produced by the effect of the more than one genes. That's why they are known as the polygenic inheritance. And in addition to the inheritance or genes, more than one gene, and they are also affected by certain environmental factors. Next example is milk urine cause. And it is also determined by their genetic, not only by the genetic makeup, but also affected by the environmental factors. But it too involves the polygenes. That's why environmental factors include the quality of the diet we are provided, we are providing the cows with, and the weather and the comfort of their surrounding. This all these all factors affect the yield of the milk in cows. So these are called the continuous variations, where we don't have the specific numbers of the variations or measurements. We have the very very broad range of the measurements, complete range. Even we can measure the variations in decimals. That's why it is known as the continuous variation. The second type of non-sex associated genetic variation is the discontinuous variation. It is controlled by allele of a single gene. Continuous variations were controlled by more than one gene, but discontinuous variations are being controlled by the alleles of a single gene or a small number of genes. The environment has little effect on this type of variations, and discontinuous variations are easily distinguishable. This is a very good example of discontinuous variation, that is the blood group. You know that we have the blood groups A, B, AB, and O. Right? So here in this graph, you can easily see that we have given the population, percentage of population with respect to their blood group, A, B, AB, and O. So populations, individuals within a population will definitely have one of these four blood groups. They could not have AO blood group, they could not have AB blood group, they could not have ABO blood group, right? There is a specific number of blood groups that a population, individuals of the population could have. So that's why these variations are called discontinuous variations. If you talk about the Mendel's pea plant, then Mendel showed that some plants are tall and some plants are short. There is no intermediate traits between them. Right, so they were also known as the discontinuous variations. Only Mendel, we are talking about Mendel pea plants, we are not talking about the rest of the plants, right? This is now in the next slide we will differentiate between the continuous variations and discontinuous variations. Continuous variation deals with few clear-cut phenotypes, right? We have clear cut, as we have given the example of blood group, we have clear cut phenotypes A, B, AB, and O.
No other phenotypes could exist for the blood group. But in case of continuous variation, it deals with a spectrum of phenotypes ranging from one extreme to the other. We have a very much broad spectrum of the phenotypes. We could have, if we talk about the skin color is a very good example of continuous variation. It ranges from the darker to lightest tone. Right? So we have the broad spectrum of phenotype in case of the skin color, in case of the height. So these all, that's why known as the continuous variation. Again, skin color is also being controlled by more than one genes. Second difference, controlled by a few genes and controlled by many genes. Genes do not show additive effect. Genes show additive effect. For example, the more dark genes, the darker will be the skin color, right? Last differences, in case of discontinuous variations, environmental factors will not affect the variation. Whether the environmental factors are good, cold or dry, a blood group of a person couldn't be changed, right? But the skin of the person could change with the environmental factors. In previous slide, we have given the example of the yield of the milk from cows. That also change with change in the environment in addition to the genetic changes. So continuous variations, discontinuous variations not modified by environmental factors, but continuous variations are modified by environmental factors. For example, greater exposure of the skin to sunlight will produce the darker skin color. Here, let's recapitulate our today's discussion. In today's discussion, we talked about the variations. Firstly, we talked about the variations, that what is variation. Variations mean variety. But our major concern was the intra-population variations. We discussed about the different kinds of variation that are being produced within the individuals of the same population. Then we talked about the different types of the intra-population variations, that are the non-genetic variations and genetic variations. Then we further divided these variations into their subtypes. Now, genetic variations have been divided into non-sex associated genetic variations and sex associated genetic variations. On the other hand, non-genetic variations have been divided into four major types: individual variation in time, social variations that are mostly present in insects, as we talked about wasp, ant, ecological variations, and traumatic variation. So this was all about the recapitulation of today's lecture. Okay, students, thank you so much. Have a great day today. Allah Hafiz.